morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Well, take a deep seat and pull down your hat. We're going to cover a lot of ground today as we lope up to the Caribou Country for a story from longtime rancher, horseman, and now TV star Roy Mulvihill.
This car was coming up through the cattle and honking horn. You couldn't see it, eh? But when it was right there, but you and the steers were veering off.
And will you hear how Roy got even with that driver? We'll also have a great story from Darrell Peterson from the time he was managing the big South Peace stock farm and ranch. And Ryan Fritz has the story of a horse that tried to buck him off after he'd roped a cow and how that led to a song. Baxter Black, always playing the angles, comes up with an alternative cattle marketing scheme called Adopt a Cow.
For your one-time donation of $3,000, you would receive an 8x10 color photo of your adopted cow.
I think he might be on to something. And the Rangeland News has the details on a story that's getting a lot of traction these days.
People are promulgating the idea that ivermectin is either a prevention or a treatment for COVID-19.
And the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight has another classic from the late and much-loved Larry McWhorter.
Feeding hay and chopping ice and tending to the weak keep cowboys on the move when northers blow. Winter brings the nursemaid out in men as cabins peak, transforms them into midwives of the snow.
The Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File looks at the question, do horses feel emotions like anger, remorse, or nostalgia? And it all starts with a great story and song from Kyle Evans, how a couple of team rovers kind of got scammed. It's called The Hustler.
I was decked out in my Wranglers and my best cowboy shirt, wearing Justin's and a Bailey shaped just right. I was mounted to the hill on the best calf horse I owned. He was quick and seasoned, really tuned up tight. Not a big money roping, just a jackpot among friends. Though they took all comers, most of them I knew. I was checking out the cattle on the backside of the pen when I saw the strangest sight come into view. 'Twas an old battered truck built some 30 years ago. It rattled as it pulled into the gate. The old sideboards were banging as the dust rolled out behind. They were driving like they thought they would be late. There were five kids in the cab, riding in the middle, with mom and dad sitting by the doors. I thought this kind of funny, but it really tickled me when I saw the kid back riding with the horse. While the stranger got his horse out, the wife and kids unloaded and sat together quietly on the ground. Then the cowboy saddled up and quickly hung his rope, and I watched him as he slowly rode around. His shirt and jeans were dirty, and they'd seen their better days. His hat was rolled and greasy on the brim. On his feet were leather work shoes, the kind a farmer wears. They were tied with twine and wearing mighty thin. His horse reminded me of horses that I'd seen at an auction headed for their final ride. A tall, big-headed thoroughbred, all scarred up on the nose, with ribs a-showing clearly through his hide. His feet were big as pancakes and nearly just as flat. I noticed that he's real cow hock behind. And anyone who'd rope on him, I'm thinking to myself, is either green or had to lost his mind. I walked up to the lady who's taking entry fees, and I pulled a roll of 20s from my shirt. As I handed her the cash, I heard a cowboy saying, I just hope this greenhorn stranger don't get hurt. Well, the roping started right on time, 16 of us entered. The score was long, the calves were running fools. The cowboys turning in the times down in the lower teens. The strangers watching staying mighty cool. My cinch is pulled, I'm powdered up, my string's between my teeth, and I ride into the box 'cause it's my turn. If these cowboys think a 13 flat is good enough to win, then these cowboys got an awful lot to learn. I nod and ride and rope him, though we use a little ground. I don't mind runners if they're running true. I flank him quick and tie him tight and mount back up again. The judge says good, the timer says 10-2. Now I'm knowing that I've got it won, and I'm feeling mighty good, though I'm trying hard not to let it show. The only thing between me and a pocket full of cash is the stranger, and he's the last to go. As he slowly rides into the pen, I'm thinking what a sight. Then all at once a change is taking place. The horse that looked so down and out has lit himself on fire, and the stranger's got a smile upon his face. He rides into the roping box and turns his mount around. The horse backs to the corner on his own. The smile is gone, there's sheer determination on his face, the likes of which I guess I've never known. He nods his head and holds his horse and never makes a move till the calf's completely cleared out of the gate. A move that's really pleasing me as I watch from the fence, cause I know this cowboy's coming way too late. But I've never seen a calf horse fire the way that pony fired, running low, his belly on the deck. They're really closing up the gap when the stranger takes his shot, and from 15 feet he ropes him round the neck. The horse sets low and sends him like a shotgun to the calf. He flanks and ties him up like a machine. He rides from the arena as the timer yells 9 flat, and I'm trying to believe what I've just seen. With my paycheck in his pocket, he puts his horse away while I'm still sitting stunned upon the fence. He quietly loads his family and leaves without a word, and no one around here has seen him since. Well, I don't know much about him, and I probably never will. I just know at hustling calves he's number one. So if you ever run into him and decide to take him on, then friend, you'd better rope him just for fun. So if you ever run into him and decide to take him on, then friend, you'd better rope him just for fun.
And sadly, that guy, Kyle Evans, died in a motorcycle accident back in 2001. We made several trips to the Peace Country for shows in Fort St. John organized by Tom Cole over the years, and while Daryl Peterson was managing the vast South Peace stock farm, we'd stop in for breakfast with him and Nancy, and Daryl always had a good story.
We had all the cattle out on pasture. We had plans for corrals out on pasture, but we started out with a set of portable corrals. And the fellows started gathering one afternoon, and it took them a little longer than they thought. But they about got all these cattle gathered, and they probably had 500-600 head stuck inside these portable corrals. And it got dark, so they decided, well, I guess we'll continue our project tomorrow morning. And they went home. Then next morning, they went out to continue their project. And I got a call in from my main cowboy on the radio saying, the cows are gone. I said, well, where'd they go? Well, the corrals are gone too, they said. I said, can't be. No one would take the corrals and the cattle. And well, they're not here. I can't see anything. And I was here last night when we left them. I said, well, they got to be there. They got to be somewhere. And, well, he says, I'll look around a little bit more. And he calls me back about 20 minutes. He says, you know, those cattle have moved a mile and a half, and they were over the hill, corrals and all.
They're still in the corral.
They were still in the corral. So we learned if you use portable corral around a big group of cattle, you better put some fence posts in.
Anchor it to something.
Well, coming up, Ryan Fritz talks about what it's like being Ian Tyson's neighbor and what led to his song called I Ride the Devil's Horse, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Our mission is to help our clients sell their equipment in the most effective way possible. People who are looking at our auction, they are literally all over North America. Once we take somebody through a process from start to finish, the first time, they get it. You know, it's very simple. It's more simple than they think.
Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. You know, Ryan Fritz is now riding for the OH Ranch on the Eastern Slopes, and it was great to catch up with him and Hoss at the 45th Annual Ivan Danes Country Music Picnic.
You know, it's been really cool for us being Ian Tyson's neighbor.
Wait,
you know,
yeah.
I go there yes. quite a bit, and he's always, you know, he lives for the song. So he'll ask me, what do you got, you know, what do you got going? So I'll play him something new, and he loves to play along, and he'll just give
he's
you.
He's still doing. He can still
yeah.
play.
Oh, yeah. And you know, lots of times he'll play his songs, and I'll sing them for him. So it's really neat.
Oh, yeah. That's great. Yeah. I can't remember. Talked to him. Oh, quite a while since I've actually talked to him, visited with him. But,
mm-hmm. Yeah. And was it two years ago? He hired Haas to do about 3 or 4 shows to be his bass player, yeah. and yeah. so that was really neat. And yeah. And
so what else is on there? You're gonna give me a little more.
All right, we'll tell you a little. Well, we got the Devil's Horse. So
yeah, I just played that one on a.
We did.
Show I did.
So,
with,
oh, you yeah.
With yeah, my neighbor Jonathan Field.
Okay.
That's an interesting story of how he wound up being my neighbor.
Yeah.
But we've ridden a lot of miles together and. He likes that one.
So, well, this one, I think it was last summer, and I'd been gone for a week or two, and when I came back to the ranch, of course, I had to go check cows, so I saddled up, and I'm just, man, this is heaven out here. It's cowboy heaven.
Yeah.
And it wasn't long after I had to doctor a calf, and, of course, my horse was a little fresh. She hadn't been rode for a bit, so she bogged her head and gave me just a little
is
bit.
Is this your mare?
Yeah, this is the mare, yeah. She's kind of the Bronco mare some days. And... But anyways, I thought, well, it's cowboy heaven, but I ride the Devil's Horse. And then
right.
yeah. I started kind of writing the lyrics to that while I was riding that day.
So that's, you know, real authentic. That came right out
that's
of
that's authentic,
exactly,
yeah.
Exactly, yeah. Cowboy heaven.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I can identify with
yeah.
that.
So you call this cowboy heaven. But I ride the Devil's Horse, throwing loops against the wind, that's Mother Nature's force. I'm mending wounds and fences, and that's just par for the course. You call this cowboy heaven, but I ride the Devil's Horse. Well, my sweetheart, she don't like it when I stay too long, tucked up in a cow camp with no telephone. Someday I may settle, but I really don't see how. No, I don't. I'll ever solve this conundrum that Tyson sang about. You call this cowboy heaven. I ride the Devil's Horse, mending wounds and fences is just par for the course. Riding the Devil's guitar, and I don't own no mouth harp. Well, I don't pick the guitar, I don't own a mouth harp. No, I don't. But these hands have done some praying, they sure can shuffle cards. Well, hard work, it don't scare me, lonely ain't no thing. Night fight the savage prairie fire, hark my mama's ring. St. Peter, don't come knocking on my cabin door. No, no, just leave me slouching in the saddle for a little while more. Well, you call this cowboy heaven, but I ride the Devil's Horse. Drank coffee and cheap whiskey, it's just par for the course, riding the Devil's Horse.
Great production, of course, produced by Ben Crane. The whole album was, in fact, and only fitting that you're going to hear a Ben Crane song. Real nice one coming up in the next segment. Well, going back to that same part of the country now. In 2000, I met three amazing ranch gals from the eastern slopes of the Rockies, three sisters, and their stories were fantastic. Here's a bit of how that one sounded. Jackie Thoreau, Nona Bonner, and Sally Conley. And they all grew up on horseback with cattle in a ranching situation and were on a lot of pack trips. And they all cooked for Andy Russell's expeditions into the Rockies. And on that program, Jackie told this story about the time Nona took Jackie on a horse buying trip.
She came roaring into the yard. I am ready. I was just going to comb my hair. Whoops. And on the shelf was a can of hairspray and a can of O-Cedar dust mop spray. She's honking her horn. I'm brushing my hair. I grabbed the spray can and I sprayed, and it was the O-Cedar dust mop, but I didn't have time to do anything about it. I went running out, jumped in the truck. We head for Paulson. It's in the summertime. It's warm. We had the windows down in the truck, and it's dusty, and my head got heavier and heavier and heavier all the way to Paulson. We got the horses out of the barn. We got them loaded. Then we had to come around by Coots because they had to be inspected by a vet because we're bringing them across the border. We were supposed to be there at 8 o'clock. We knew we weren't. She phoned. She's uptight. I said, why bother putting the money in the phone? Because they can hear you. Because she's standing at, I'm coming. So anyway, the vet said, oh, calm down. I only live a couple of blocks from the station there. And when you get there, just phone and I'll come up. So we got there about midnight. He came up, examined the horses. I rolled in the window. He sort of got this beautiful smell of old cedar dust mop that was filling the cabin, my hair hanging like this. He said, where did you come from this morning? I said, Pincher Creek. He says, where are you going back tonight? I said, Pincher Creek. He said, God, I'm sure glad I'm not you.
And to make it worse, the dust mop didn't work with the darn of that hairspray on it.
No, it didn't.
Okay, now, coming up, you won't want to miss Baxter Black's great new cattle marketing scheme when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Howdy, friends. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, and I'll be right back after this
with a little peek at Adopt a Cow.
Animal Health Express is your partner in animal health solutions, offering everything you need from livestock vaccines, vitamins and wormers, antibiotics and medications, to instruments and ear tags. They also have a large selection of tack and roping needs for the working cowboy. Independently owned and operated since 1990 by Tim and Barbara Jackson. Animal Health Express, for ranchers who mean business. 800-533-8115 or online at animalhealthexpress.com.
Back in their heyday, the Hare Krishna devised a fundraising program called Adopt a Cow. His Grace, the Swami Prabhupada, established a beautiful farm community as a place of pilgrimage devoted to cow protection. For your one-time donation of $3,000, you would receive an 8x10 color photo of your adopted cow, a gold certificate, G. Burphy and Sandish, periodic news of your cow's progress, and a get-acquainted vacation weekend to visit your cow. Now, personally, I think it's a pretty good idea. Farmers and ranchers have been searching for innovative marketing ideas. We're always trying to diversify. We still think the only way to make money is to produce more than our neighbor. But what's wrong with Adopt a Cow? The BLM got away with their Adopt a Horse program, and the Democrats have been successful with their Adopt a Minority group. It could be instituted through our associations or by individual producers. Imagine, adopt a pig, adopt a row of corn, or adopt a grape. The idea would spread. Adopt a combine, adopt a county agent, adopt a cowboy. Groups outside of agriculture would soon be competing for the suburban sympathy dollar. Adopt an oil well, adopt a shopping mall parking space, adopt a railroad tie. AT&T would sponsor an Adopt a Telephone Pole program. You'd get an 8x10 glossy of your poll, periodic news on its progress, and a one-week vacation to visit your poll for only $5,000. The Pentagon could cut expenses and stimulate interest by starting an adopt-a-nuclear-missile campaign. The Hare Krishna had a good idea, but it's not new. One group has already mastered the system. Collectively, we pay them millions of dollars every year, and in return, we get their photo in campaign brochures, periodic updates through the media, and they travel to see us when they want to be reelected. Unfortunately, many of them are already adopted before the general public has a chance to buy in. The NRA, the AFL-CIO, defense contractors have maintained an adopt-a-legislator program for years. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan. Thanks for listening.
If you're buying or selling farm machinery, heavy equipment, or trucks, let Progressive Auctions take the hassle out of your sale or your search. There's an online auction every Wednesday at progressiveauctions.ca. Doesn't matter where you live, Progressive Auctions can find the machinery or equipment you need or the buyers who are looking for what you're selling. ProgressiveAuctions.ca. For more information, call 844-309-9424. Just ahead of the Rangeland News, the recording of that song you heard by Ryan Fritz was produced and engineered by Ben Crane. And now, here's Ben with one of those great ones written by Jesse Ballantyne.
Old Bill is getting older. He feels it in his bones when it gets cold. Last year he took a room in town with a window that looks right down on a quiet street in a little northern cow town. He came up the trail years ago, pushing some of old man Chisholm's steers. Just a kid, but man enough. They say he was a little bit tough, the kind of man that gave the ladies cause to wonder. It's all behind him now, and you can find him now on that old boardwalk, telling tall ones. He's got his memories where he rides wild and free, and it pleases him just to dream, old cowboy dreams. Kind of a hero around town, a different breed, a man from yesterday. He's got a past that he can't hide from, and a standing invitation at every door and table in town. It's all behind him now, and you can find him now on that old boardwalk, telling tall ones. He's got his memories where he rides wild and free, and it pleases him just to dream, old cowboy dreams. Yes, it pleases him just to dream, old cowboy dreams.
In our many travels over the years, Billy and I have stayed in a lot of hotels. And you know, one of our absolute favorites is the Cambridge in Red Deer, Alberta. So many times for the main event, the Ivan Dean's Country Music Picnic, and other occasions, it's like a second home to us. You know, there's no better place to have a conference, a convention, a meeting, or a wedding, or a family reunion. Three great restaurants, and they really make you feel at home. And oh, those beds and pillows are so comfortable. We highly recommend it. And you can call toll-free 1-800-662-7197 from wherever you are.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
Thanks, Jeff. At the top of page one, here's what it says. Several months ago, I had a good long discussion with a large animal industry vet friend of mine, and you didn't hear it. We talked about the subject of the parasite control drug ivermectin having potential for easing the symptoms of COVID-19. And we didn't hear much about that until the last few weeks, and now we're hearing a lot about it. And here's an interesting report from USDA's Gary Crawford.
If you've got livestock, you may be familiar with the drug ivermectin, which is used to treat parasitic worms in horses and cattle. But in at least two states, and maybe more...
People are promulgating the idea that ivermectin is either a prevention or a treatment for COVID-19.
But Dr. Fred Gehr, professor emeritus at the University of Iowa, told a special webinar put on by AgriSafe that first...
There is absolutely no evidence that ivermectin is beneficial for COVID-19 prevention or treatment.
And in fact, using it is dangerous. People are overdosing on this animal drug. And in fact, right now...
The single most common telephone call to the Poison Control Center in Louisiana now is for ivermectin overdose.
And the Mississippi Department of Health says over 75% of calls to its Poison Control Center are from people overdosing by taking the ivermectin designed for cattle and horses. So if you're thinking about taking ivermectin to treat or prevent COVID, Dr. Gehr's strong advice...
Don't do it.
Gary Crawford reporting for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Health Canada has said it's closely monitoring all potential therapeutic treatments for COVID-19, including treatments being studied in international clinical trials, but has not, they say, received any drug submission or clinical trial application for ivermectin as it applies to COVID-19. The department said it'll continue to monitor the situation and will take appropriate and timely action should new information become available, including any information regarding illegal advertising or sale of ivermectin. A U.S. environmental group that wants to end public land grazing has outbid a rancher in central Idaho for a grazing lease on state land. The Western Watersheds Project bid $8,200 a couple of weeks ago for a 20-year grazing lease on 620 acres in Idaho's Sawtooth Valley. The Western Wildlife Project has been at odds with Western ranchers for decades, openly campaigning against livestock grazing on public lands, claiming it's devastating to natural habitats. Winning the bid in last week's auction opens the door to other environmental groups competing with ranchers for state and federal permits. Funded by donors, groups like WWP are not burdened by the profit motives from grazing livestock, and they can gladly outbid the ranchers who've held the leases for years. And some of the ranchers are saying, boy, that's an alarming precedent. And a global news story says a spike in hay prices in Alberta and across much of Western Canada has some livestock producers fearful of what's to come. According to one analyst, a lack of feed could not only make the beef on your plate more expensive, it could also put producers out of business. Last year was a pretty good one, though, for hay and forage around here. I think it averaged about $100 to $120 a ton, and this year, if you can find it, it's much higher. And I've heard about some loads of 50 to 65-pound square bales, mostly grass with a little alfalfa, going for up to 10 bucks each, and in some cases, 15. And I think we paid 5 last year. Next Raider cattle sale, plus a special yearling and calf sale, is September the 28th at the Kamloops, B.C. yards of the B.C. Livestock Co-op. September 29th, a calf sale in Williams Lake, and the Williams Lake regular sale September 30th, and a regular cattle sale in Vanderhoof October 1st. To get all the information, see the sales live at bclivestock.bc.ca.
Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, of course, regular cattle sales every Wednesday, pre-sort calf sales now on Mondays, and Friday, October 1st, it's the Wine Glass Ranch Quarter Horse Sale. That's in the evening, and then Saturday, October 2nd, another horse sale. To book your cattle, you can call the Innisfail Auction Market, 1-800-710-3166. Are you ready for the final item? Well, this one actually came in a dream I had the other night after my neighbor Jonathan Field was leaving for his camps and clinics at the Horse in Hand Ranch near Black Falls, Alberta. And I was dreaming that a couple of large animal vets were building a clinic for horses right next to it, specializing in preg testing for mares, and they were calling it Hand in Horse. And Billy said, don't use that one. That's the Rangeland News. Coming up in the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, I'll give you my answer to some real interesting questions about what horses feel and think when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Can horses experience emotions like happiness, anger, remorse, or nostalgia? Or is it just pleasure and pain, and do they understand punishment? Those are some of the questions we'll look at on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File coming right up. We were looking at some of the photos of our Spirit of the West Alaska cruise a few years back and thinking, yeah, after all of this time, that would be about the nicest getaway we could have. And, you know, things seem to be changing, but nobody knows for sure. But we are still tentatively scheduling our farewell Spirit of the West cruise to begin June the 15th, 2022, with a 7-day trip up the Inside Passage to Alaska and back to Vancouver. Now, these days, of course, we don't know what's over the next hill, and I don't think anybody else does either. But our longtime cruise directors, Jim and Karen, have all the information on how you can tentatively book your spot for this potential great trip. Their number is 1-800-530-0131. And there's a lot of information on our cruise pages at our website, hugh-mclennan.com.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Just like that, in the blink of an eye, we've gone from stay home to suit up for all those reunions, rodeos, birthdays, and other big events. So I figure now would be a good time to update your look with help from my friends at Irvine's. A huge selection of Western wear with a welcome twist, over 110,000 square feet. Something for everyone. Irvine Tack and Western Wear, exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield, or shop online at irvines.ca.
Canada's largest Western store.
I was looking over Jonathan Field's Open Field Forum the other day, and an interesting group of questions came up. You can find Jonathan's answers at jonathanfieldhorsemanship.net, but I thought, no, I got some ideas on this too. The question was, can horses experience complex emotions like happiness, anger, remorse, or nostalgia? Or is it just pleasure and pain? And also, can horses understand punishment? Well, to me, the first one's obvious, happiness. Oh, yeah, just watching a few colts frolicking around together in a pasture, watching a couple of horses who are best friends and have been separated for a while get back together, or a group of horses turned out to a big pasture after a hard day's work. Looks like they're happy to me. Anger? Oh, I think so. When a new horse is turned in with an existing herd without any formal introductions, the expressions of the herd members and the gestures directed towards the newcomer indicate anger. Remorse. Well, I don't think horses process things the same way we do. I've never had even a real good horse apologize after bucking me off or stepping on my foot. I'm pretty sure their consciousness is much more in the present moment than ours is. And as far as pleasure and pain, well, there's no question they sure do feel pain, and they certainly do feel fear. The interesting thing is that sometimes fear can be a stronger force to them than pain.
It's amazing how a horse will continue to work even though he's dealing with considerable pain from anything from an irritating cinch gall to a sore back. But fear sometimes will prevent him from being able to perform. And do they experience pleasure? I'm pretty sure they do. When I start rubbing Cody's belly with my hand, she'll often start moving her lips and nodding her head much the way they do when they're mutual grooming. Punishment. Well, I'd have to draw a line between discipline and punishment. If, for example, a horse tries to bite me, my immediate response is to do something that will immediately indicate to him that he's crossed the line. It's likely a rap on the nose at the time he tries to bite, and then, if possible, move his hindquarters away from me, disengaging them in each direction to remind him of his place in our relationship. Oh boy, this could be a long, fascinating, interesting discussion. Thanks for a real good question. And for Irvin Saddles and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. Our horses get a daily feeding of something that sure helps them feel good and keeps them going, and that's Hoffman's Horse Ration. Been riding poor old Cody about 8 or 10 days in a row, and some pretty good hard days gathering cattle, and she's still going strong, and she's 19. You can find out what's in it and all about it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. The way the Canada Revenue Agency deals with ranchers and farmers has changed a lot in the last few years, and the financial decisions we make today can have a long-lasting impact on our bottom line far into the future. It really helps to have a trusted professional who really understands your situation to guide you with all your accounting requirements and your tax preparation. Having an accountant who knows the difference between a Hereford and a heifer, what a slick and backgrounding are, and that Alfalfa and Timothy are not just names from a storybook really helps. Kathy McMillan of PMT Chartered Professional Accountants understands the intricacies of specialized programs like AgriStability and AgriInvest. She understands the demands on your time and can help you spend more time doing your job and less time dealing with endless piles of paperwork. See PMTAccountants.com or call toll-free 877-383-8081. A tourist driving a Volkswagen Beetle encounters a big herd of cattle being driven by Roy Mulvihill on a lonely caribou back road, and the tourist thinks he can just honk his horn and push his way on through the steers. And you'll hear what happened next after a song I like to dig out every year, this time from Ranger Doug and Riders in the Sky.
Just a cowboy riding home in early autumn, with a heavy heart, the lonely trails I ride. As I roam each dusty ridge and river bottom, and wonder at the love she cast aside.
Through the empty sage and sand I slowly wander. I have met
horizons waiting way out yonder.
Early autumn, just a cowboy riding upon the saddle, sighs like winds through golden aspen leaves, dreams like photographs and the memory of her smile is all that lingers. Early autumn, just a cowboy riding home.
Not much can raise your stress level more than a tractor breakdown when you need it most. We've all spent hours on the phone and driving around trying to find the right parts, and that's no fun when you're missing something you need to finish the job. Here's a better way. Just go to bctractorparts.com. That's where you can find about any part for any make or tractor. If you're restoring a vintage tractor or just keeping up the maintenance on the ones you're using, you can have the parts you need in a short time. And you know what? There's some great pictures of tractor restoration projects and much more right there at bctractorparts.com. What? Oh, you don't have internet? Well, try calling Mark at 250-395-0960.
Billy and I got to take in the Williams Lake Bull Sale, where we visited with some of the cowboys of BC's caribou country, and Roy Mulvihill told us about the last big cattle drive with about 1,000 steers coming from the Chilcotin country right into Williams Lake.
And this car was coming up through the cattle and honking horn. You couldn't see it, eh? But when it was right there, but the steers was veering off, and the riders went down over the hill to gather these steers, and I just taken the rope off, and I got back on my horse, and I was just breaking this big horse, and I couldn't see the car because the steers was higher than the beetle was, and so I hurries up there to get him stopped and got out in front of him, and he wouldn't stop. He just kept coming towards me, so I dropped my rope on the side of the bumper,
yeah,
and I just spun him around in the road, and he's a hollering at me. He says, "You can't do that. You can't do that." And I takes the rope off, and I says, "Now I got you turned around." I says, "You go back where you come from." His wife was just a hollering at him, and she said, "Let's get out of here. Get out of here." And the steers were just going like crazy in every direction. And he's no way he'd budge, so I dropped the rope on, and I give him another spin clean around. It was a dirt road, and he locked the brakes on, but I hooked it on, and my horse was scared of it. As soon as it moved, he just spun that thing right around in the road, and the second time I spun him around, he got in that thing, and down the road he went. We never seen him again, but it took us two days to get those steers all gathered up,
because
scrambled, and they got mixed up with other ranchers' cattle and whatnot.
Yeah, sometimes, I guess. City people coming to cattle country don't quite understand the code and the traditions. Coming up, I'll see if you can guess the singer of this week's classic Western song, and then the late and much-loved Larry McWhorter in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. This week's classic Song of the West has been around for a long, long time. In one of John Lomax's books, you'll find about 6 pages of the verses. And a lot of the verses just can't be published or broadcast for obvious reasons. It's one of those jam session songs where you can just keep making up more verses all night long. This one gives you the basics, and see if you can guess who the singer is with the old Chisholm drink.
Well, come along, boys, and listen to me tell. I'll tell you about my troubles on the old Chisholm Trail. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy. I started up the trail October 23rd. Started up the trail with a U2 herd. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ippy-ippy. On a $10 horse and a $40 saddle, started out punching them longhorn cattle. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ippy. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ay. With the seat in the saddle and the hand on the horn, I'm the best dang cowboy that was ever born. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ippy-ay. Come and tie-i-ippy-ippy-ay. It's cloudy in the west and looking like rain, and the dango slickers in the wagon again. Gonna tie I yippee yippee yippee, gonna tie I yippee yippee. The wind began to blow and the rain began to fall, and it looked like we were gonna lose them all. Gonna tie I yippee yippee yippee, gonna tie I yippee yippee. No chaps, no slippers, and it's pouring down rain. I swear I'll never not hurt again. Come a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. Come a tie, I yippee yippee. I crippled my horse, and I don't know how. Roping these longhorn you two cows. Come a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. Come a tie, I yippee yippee. Draw my roll, and the boss had me figured $9 in the hole. Come a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. Come a tie, I yippee yippee. Well, me and the boss, we had a little spat, so I hit him in the face with my 10-gallon hat. Come a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. Come a tie, I yippee yippee. The boss says to me, well, I'll fire you, not only you, but the whole darn crew. Come a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. Come a tie, I yippee yippee. I'll sell my horse, I'll sell my saddle, and you can drive all your longhorn cattle. Come a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. Come a tie, I yippee yippee. I'm a tie, I yippee yippee yippee. I'm a tie, I yippee yippee.
Ah, you knew that, I bet. Of course, it was Randy Travis. And you know, the poetry of the late Larry McWhorter, I think, will live on for a long, long time to come. And to give a little insight into what kind of a great human being Larry was, I'd like to bring in my good friend, Red Steagall.
I'll never forget the first time I heard Larry McWhorter do poetry. And we sat down, and I listened to it, and I thought, now, this guy really understands what he's writing about. And then I realized that he had grown up in the panhandle of Texas. I got better acquainted with him, and I knew the places and the faces and the people who he was talking about. And Larry wrote about a lifestyle that we worked so hard to preserve, and he did such a marvelous job of writing about it. He was a good horseman. He knew a lot about cattle. He was a great musician. And a great singer, and a good friend. And I was so proud when he got invited to go to Elko that first year. And he made a place for himself in the world of cowboy poetry. My friend, Larry McWhorter.
Feeding hay and chopping ice and tending to the weak keep cowboys on the move when northers blow. Winter brings the nursemaid out in men as Kevin's peak transforms them into midwives of the snow. The dreary days of winter finally lose their lease on life. A briskness in the air replaces sting. The colt comes out in cowboys as they shed their winter coats and revel in the glory that is spring. Summertime means prowling, checking fence and water holes, while staying on the hunt for errant cattle. Time and miles are easy found for giving Bronx their schooling with teacher at the desk, which is his saddle. Circling geese at sundown warn it's getting cold up north when frost replaces what was morning dew. Falling leaves and weanling calves are autumn's telling signs that aging things must make way for the new.
Thank you so much for riding along, and I sure hope you can join up again next week right here at the same time. And as always, thanks to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And you know, if you enjoy this program, I know you'll love Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. You can subscribe online at cowboycountrymagazine.com. I hope you can check out our YouTube channel for all the programs. They're there with video. And our podcast version, you can download it and take it along with you. The links are on our website, hugh-mclennan.com.
Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.